Hare Krishna. Thank you for coming today evening. I'm grateful to be here with all of you. And we'll need to switch off some of the lights.
Yeah, it's okay.
So I'll speak today on a topic which I have been contemplating for the last several months. I was in America for about 2.5 months, then I went to Canada, and Europe. I've been touring and especially speaking to students and companies. I spoke at Stanford and Harvard and Google and Intel. And after that, when I was talking with people, one of the things which common situation that I faced was people are immensely dissatisfied. So the topic, which is learning to live with and within our limitations. When people are dissatisfied, one reason for dissatisfaction, for example, I was speaking in Yale, and after that I was talking with some students. Yale is on the top university, it's Ivy League university, and these students have achieved what most students across the world dream about. And yet, most of the students there are in so much insecurity, so much anxiety, and not just insecurity and anxiety about their future. Just being in the Ivy League university means they are going to have a bright future. But their insecurity is based on comparison. So one student is telling or that actually whenever I see another student who is better than me, I feel inferior. And whenever I see a student who I am better than, I feel better. So half of the time I am feeling good about myself and half of the time I am feeling terrible about myself. And this is a common situation. And this, the kind of dissatisfaction causes so much unnecessary distress. So I'll talk about this theme of how all of us have limitations, but we can live within those limitations and we can achieve satisfaction. Now, limitations can be of various kinds. Is somebody operating this from there, or
you want to operate?
I can operate also. You can just keep it up. Oh, this is a clicker. Thank you.
This is a Bluetooth.
Which one?
So just click this one. It will go to the next.
Just click. Let me see, keep it here. Just move it forward now. Maybe some, you can just move it forward till then. Thank you. So these are three broad points that I'll talk about. If you want to find satisfaction in life, if you don't want to be insecure, this we have to live, we have to accept the material reality of how things are. We aspire for spiritual growth and spiritual reality. And this dissatisfaction which I talked about, it is not just for so non-devotees who are competing in the material world. Even in the devotee community, I've seen so much dissatisfaction. Some devotee can sing very well, another devotee can't sing so well. Some devotee is in a very leading and prominent position doing a lot of other lot of services. Some devotees are not able to do that much services, that kind of visible prominent services, that may cause dissatisfaction. So this dissatisfaction can keep us unhappy, not just in our material life, but it can keep us unhappy even in our spiritual life. Three broad points for dealing with this is, first, accept the material reality as it is. Then we aspire for spiritual reality. Spiritual reality means spiritual realization, spiritual growth. And then along the journey, we act to find the balance. Because to get spiritual realization is a long journey. So let's look at each of these points one by one. So dissatisfaction can cause enormous frustration. I was in America, there's a big redwood forest. And there's a tree which had existed for almost 150 years. And that tree, big storms came, hurricanes, tornadoes, the tree didn't fall. And one day, tuck, the tree fell down because of nothing. And they found, what happened? What caused this giant tree, which is a survivor, to fall down? And they found that the tree had become filled with termites, white ants from within. And now this tree is giant, the termites are insignificant. But that tree which had survived huge storms fell because of some tiny termites. So similarly, tiny dissatisfactions, tiny irritations, tiny resentments, they can accumulate within us. And they can eat us up from within. Even if externally we are successful, the world is looking up and admiring us, but internally we may be eaten by these petty dissatisfactions. But they will not stay petty, their effects will not be at all pretty, it will be terrible. What do I do? You can just operate it from your phone. Let's keep it simple. What needs to be done? Can you show me?
It's like you just press once.
The right one?
Yeah.
The left
one. Left one? Okay, let's see.
Right now, I'll just go to previous slide.
Okay, let's.
So, you just click this button, it will go next.
In left and right?
Yeah.
Okay, and this is forward? No.
No, for going back, it will call for.
Okay. You just go back to slides and come back. So move forward from there.
Oh, amazing. Amazing.
No worries, I'll operate.
Oh, you'll operate from here.
Okay, just move back. Yes.
Is this?
Move back. One more slide. Go ahead. Thank you. So, okay. So, let's start with the incident from the Ramayana. In the Ramayana, we see that the Vanaras, they were deputed to search for Sita. And all these Vanaras were very greatly devoted. Angad, Jambavan, Neel, Hanuman, all of them, they were a part of that special team that was sent southwards. Although Vanaras went in all four directions, but this team which went southward, they were the most probable to find Sita, because Sita had been seen taken southwards. So when they came to the ocean, now all of them were empowered, but they were all honest. Oh, this distance is so big. So one of them said, oh, I can jump this much. I can jump this much, I can jump this much. So although each one of them would have loved to do that service of jumping across the ocean and going to Lanka to find Sita, but they recognized their limitations. If they had not recognized their limitations, they said, Angad said, I can go. Jambavan said, I can go. All that would have happened is, the mission would have been unsuccessful. The mission would have been unsuccessful. But they humbly acknowledged, yes, we can't jump. And then, what to do? They all turned to Hanuman. Jambavan especially turned to Hanuman. Jambavan reminded Hanuman of his power, and Hanuman leapt across. And when Hanuman went there, Hanuman also had such a devotional consciousness. When he went there, he wreaked havoc. And when he set Lanka on fire, and when he was coming back, at that time, he said, standing on the border wall of Lanka, which is about to collapse because of the fire, he roared out to the Rakshasas and he said, I am the least powerful among the thousands of servants of Ram. And if Ravan doesn't return Sita, thousands of such monkeys will come and destroy Lanka. So he didn't think, I am such a great warrior, see what I have done. He said, I am a servant. And he didn't just talk about his power, he talked about the power of all the other Vanaras. And when the Vanaras had gone, when Hanuman had gone, the Vanaras told him that we will stand here and till the time you come back, we will perform tapasya. And they said that we will stand on one foot with our other foot raised and we will chant Om and we will invoke good wishes for you. So although they could not go, they didn't resent, they didn't envy, nor did they just sit passively. They did their part, offering their good wishes, performing austerities. And in this way, the whole mission was dramatically successful. So for all of us, we have certain limitations. Some of us may be very good at organizing things. Some of us may be very good at, writing, making things linguistically attractive. Some of us may be very good at aesthetics. So we all at decorating things attractively. So by the same person who may be very good at organizing schedules, that person may not be very good at writing. Same person may be who is very good at writing may not be very good at visual decorations. So we all have certain limitations. And when we accept these limitations, then we can move forward as a team. We do our part and others do their part. Now sometimes in society, whether it is a material society or a spiritual society, certain things get glamorized. Certain roles get glamorized. Say for example, say among Indian families, say the careers of engineering and medicine are quite glamorized. So most parents want their children. I want my child to become an engineer. I want my child to become a doctor. So then this creates a pressure. So when I was in America and I was giving a class, I was talking about how certain careers may be glamorized and engineering may be glamorized. So then my audience started laughing. He says, what is, so the American, afterward an American audience person told me, he says, what is glamorous about engineering? He says, America is filled with Indian engineers. It is so common, but still somehow that is glamorized over there. Right. So now, when certain things are glamorized, some children may be talented in something else. Somebody may be very good at maths and they can do something in that area. Somebody may be very good at art. But people start feeling inferior and inadequate because they are not good at something which is glamorized. And the same thing can happen in the devotee community. Say sometimes those who can speak nicely or those who can lead kirtan nicely, they may get very visible services. And others, they may feel, oh, I don't get this kind of service. And they may try to take up that service. But they may not have that ability. So now, of course, we can try to develop certain abilities. But there are certain limitations which we all have. And then, when we acknowledge those limitations, we can move forward looking at what we have. So, why I gave the example of Angad here is, Angad and Jambavan is that, a limitation in ability is not limitation in spirituality. A limitation in the material ability does not limit our spiritual growth. It does not limit who we are. It may limit us in doing some particular actions. So if somebody who is very good at speaking, they may just effortlessly, eloquently give classes and they inspire people. But some people, to give a class, it causes so much tension. Oh, what will I speak? What if I forget this point? How will I prepare this? Where will I do this? For some people, giving a class means it's like a huge tension. One class, one devotee told me, if I have to give a class, you have to tell me 3 months before. Then I will prepare and give a class. But there are some speakers, in 3 months, they will give us 100 classes. One class every day, two classes every day, 100 classes they will give. So, all of us have different abilities. Now, there's a shoe that fits one foot can bite another foot. The shoe fits one person very nicely, but the other person's leg is different. Similarly, all of us, we can say, are cut differently. But the service, the ability, the particular activity which may energize, inspire one person, the thing which one person may be very good at, another person may not be good at it. So these are limitations on all of us, Because our body and mind are structured in a particular way.
Okay.
So, now dissatisfaction is caused not just because we don't have certain ability. This has been historically also true. They're all, no, even in the past, different people had different abilities. The problem in today's society is that the comparison has increased. Why has the comparison increased? Because we have become like a global village. So if we buy a new phone, then we compare our phone not just with the people around us, we can know about which brand is there in which part of the world. And my phone is great. One devotee told me he had a desire to buy a BMW. And he worked very hard, earned a lot of money, took a big loan, and he got a BMW. And when he was living in a small town, and he drove with that BMW in this town, and everybody was admiring. And then he came to the city also, and that BMW was not that common in that city. He drove there, and still wherever he would go, people would look and admire. And then within 2 months, after he came from that town to the city, that same car brought a new model. And then he was driving along the road, and that same lane where he was staying, another person got this newer brand of the car. And he says, nobody was looking at me now. So, as a Western thinker who said, fashion is a form of ugliness so intolerable that we have to change it every 6 months. Normally, the fashion is beautiful, fashion is cool. Yes, everybody wants to be fashionable, more tip-top, modern. Yes, but the same thing that is fashionable now, after a few months, it becomes old-fashioned. And for a person who prides on being fashionable, there is no put-down, no insult as painful as being told, hey, you are old-fashioned. So it keeps us very insecure and dissatisfied. Because today, our comparison point is not just our society or our community. Because through advertisements, through the media, through the interconnectedness of the technocentric world, we can see what who has everywhere in the world. And that's why people feel so insecure. So it could be with respect to our positions, it can be with respect to our appearance, it can be with respect to our abilities, whatever it is. But if we keep comparing, we will keep staying dissatisfied. Now at one level, comparison is unavoidable. We live in a competitive society. So if a student is giving an exam, you'll see, okay, came first or second or third or fourth or tenth or whatever. So at a functional level, comparison and competition are unavoidable. But there is a functional level and there is a fundamental level. If we start defining ourselves in terms of where we stand in the functional level, for a student, the grades or the marks they get are important. But the student is not just the grade or the marks. If we are working in a company or wherever we are working or earning, how much we earn is important. But the person's self-worth is not their net worth. The person is more than their marks or more than their salary. But when we start defining ourselves in that terms, that is when the problem comes. So at a functional level, competition and comparison are required. But at a definitional level, who am I? If I define myself only in terms of that comparison, then it will be a problem. I saw an ad once, it says, you are your car. It's you are your car. Now we give the example of the car body to say how the soul is different from the body. To identify with the body is itself illusion. But to identify with the car, that is, you could say illusion squared. Isn't it illusion squared? So now I was thinking that Sanskrit word for misidentification, ahankar. If you change it slightly, you can have ahamkar. I am my car. Ahamkar. So basically, to the extent we start identifying ourselves with something external, then that is what causes insecurity. Now Angad, Hanum, Angad, Jambavan, Neil, all of them, they didn't identify themselves simply by their ability to jump. Okay, I can't jump that much. But still, I am also a vanar leader, I am also a servant of Ram, and I will serve in what way I can. So functionally, comparison is required, but foundationally, in terms of our self-worth and self-identity, we need a deeper security. And that deeper security comes from our spirituality. So before I go to the spirituality, one more point over here, that when we seek satisfaction in our lives, there is this idea that the more I possess, the happier I'll become. It could be in terms of gadgets, it could be in terms of real estate, it could be just in terms of money, whatever it is. Now it's there are many researchers who have studied happiness. In fact, happiness is a big field of study in psychology and sociology nowadays. And researchers have found something very similar. If we consider the graph of happiness versus wealth, this is, say, y-axis is happiness, x-axis is wealth. So they find that there is initially a straight correlation. If a person is living below the poverty line, if a person doesn't have enough money even for food or clothing or shelter, then, as their money increases, their happiness increases. It's actually not exactly that happiness is increasing, rather their distress is decreasing. Because not having food, not having clothes, this is distressful. And money can remove that distress. So up to a particular point, if you consider this graph, up to a particular point where the basic needs are met, the correlation is linear. But after that, they found that there is no correlation at all. It becomes completely arbitrary. Sometimes a person who is in the middle class, that person might be happier, and a person who is in a way upper class might not be happy, might be dissatisfied. So what's happening over here? That beyond a particular point, wealth can't provide us happiness. Actually, even to that point, wealth doesn't provide happiness. What it does it? Wealth removes distress. It's a function. If I have hunger, hunger is a pain. And if I have money to buy food, then that pain can be removed. But beyond that, happiness depends not on how much money a person has, but how much purpose, how much of a sense of purpose that a person has. That means that our happiness depends not on what we drive, not on what car we drive, but our happiness depends on what drives us. What are we living for? If a person has a huge house, but that person has, in climbing to the top and getting that big house, has spoiled all relationships, alienated everyone, and is lonely. And the big house will only provide the privilege of a lot of space in which to feel lonely and unhappy. So after a particular point, the happiness depends on the values that are driving a person. What is the purpose for which they are living? Now, making money is important, but making something worthwhile with money is even more important. What are we doing with the money that we have? That will determine our satisfaction much more. So that's why even if we do not have the kind of gadgets or luxuries or wealth that is glamorized in the media, you might see in movies, in advertisements, that doesn't have, getting it will not necessarily make us happy, and not having it doesn't necessarily have to make us unhappy. So accepting our material situation becomes easier when we understand that these material things, they in themselves do not make me happy. What will make me happy is, what is the purpose of my life? What am I living for? That is what will be provided by our spirituality. So I'll take this class in three parts, as I mentioned, three points. At this point, the first point was, we need to accept our material reality, so that we can avoid constant dissatisfaction. Any questions at this point? After each part, I'll have a break for questions. If any of you have any questions or any comments. Yes, please.
Material reality, we know we have limitations, but our mind doesn't know. It tells always that we should be, I have more things to acquire. So how we convince ourselves of that?
Okay. So our mind always craves for more and more. So how can we deal with that? Growth is a natural feature of the living condition. All of us were unicellular organisms at one time. Now we have grown to be living beings with millions of cells. So growing is natural. Similarly, wanting to grow in various aspects of our life. We grow in our professional career to a higher position, to grow in our financial security or financial level, to grow in our social connections, to become more respected in society. This is all natural. This itself is just a part of the normal living condition. Growth is natural. Cancer is also growth. Now when we develop a tumor which will later become cancerous, what is happening? That's also cells in the body itself. But that growth is disproportionate. And when it is disproportionate, it becomes destructive. One set of cells start growing so much that they start damaging and destroying other parts of the body. So similarly, if the craving for one thing starts becoming disproportionate, healthy growth is proportionate growth. Unhealthy growth is disproportionate growth. So when the craving for one thing becomes disproportionate, that means when making money becomes so obsessive for us that we start neglecting our family, we start neglecting our bhakti, we start neglecting even our health, then that is a time when a person is becoming manic about money. So that is an unhealthy craving. So if we have a sense of balance, that okay, I want to grow in this area of my life, I want to get more, but not at this cost. So if we set limits for ourselves, then we can't immediately renounce those cravings. We can't immediately tell our mind, just shut up. The mind keeps, I want this, I want this. We can't immediately be purified of all those desires. So we may pursue some desires, but we create fences for ourselves. That means, okay, this much time I'll work, and this much time, if I work, what I can earn, with that I will grow. But if just so that I can earn more and more, instead of say working at 8 hours, 10 hours, I start working 12 hours, 14 hours, 16 hours. That is unhealthy spiritually, unhealthy materially also. Unhealthy relationally, unhealthy physically. So we have to have a sense of proportion. And if we get the sense of proportion, and especially if we give due time for our spiritual growth, then that itself will help us to get the clarity, get the intelligence, get the level-headedness by which we can have that sense of proportion. Does it answer your question? Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Yes.
Regarding this teachings of Bhagavad-Gita, Bhagavatam. So in the university it is not taken as one of the things, because we understand that our ability or whatever we want to do, we have a limitation. And that limitation is, I mean, connected to the Lord or Krishna, that is the actual that way it gives. But this knowledge is not given in the university. How people should understand that, then dissatisfaction may be less. What can balance this?
That's true, yeah. So this knowledge, spiritual knowledge, is not available in the universities today that can help students deal with dissatisfaction. Yeah, we live in a multicultural world today where there are people from different faith traditions, And because of that, knowledge from any one particular tradition, people are a little apprehensive about receiving it. But if it's presented properly, see, the Bhagavad Gita can be presented as a religious text. We can say this is the word of God and this is authority. Now, as soon as it's presented like that, people will turn off. Who knows? How can you say this is the word of God? What is the proof? In our tradition, we know a different God. But if you just present the Bhagavad Gita as a wisdom text, not as a religious text, then people are open for it. I have spoken myself and I have had friends speaking in big, big companies and top universities. If you present wisdom and then say this wisdom is from the Bhagavad Gita, then people are okay with it. Gita is an ancient wisdom text, it talks about yoga. So what we need to do is find out how to present the concepts in a way that it can reach to people. So the presenting anything as an authority, that doesn't work. Today's culture is very anti-authority in general. So the postmodern, the Western world is increasingly being swept by what is called the postmodernism. Postmodernism is where people don't accept any authority at all. But if something makes sense to them, if something feels good to them, if something works for them in terms of improving the quality of their lives, then people are very much open for it. So if we could present spiritual knowledge as principles of living, as wisdom, and sometimes we may not even necessarily quote from the scripture. We can just present the principles without necessarily quoting from the principles, quoting from the scripture. So we are presenting the principles. So the idea that there is that we are different from our mind. I've spoken across various universities and I found that if you tell people you're not the body, you're not that interested. You're not that interested. You tell people you are not your mind, they are very much interested. Because everybody is troubled by their mind. And the metaphor that I use for explaining that is, I use a computer system. That there is the body, mind and soul are like the hardware, software and user. So the hardware is the body, software is the mind and the soul is the user. And then I tell how certain pop-ups come in our computer, on our device, but we don't necessarily click on it. We observe it and we decide whether I want to process it or not. So basically, if we explain to people in terms of what they need, so everybody is troubled by their mind right now. And if you can explain to people, you are different from your mind, you can distance yourself from the emotions and the passions of your mind and process them appropriately. So people are very interested in understanding how we are different from our mind. And if they accept they are different from their mind, they already accept that they are different from their body. So in that sense, we have to find out what is the felt need of people. There's a traditional Subhashita which says that even the most expert shoe seller will not find a market amongst an assembly of naked sadhus. There's some Naga Babas, they don't wear any clothes. You cannot sell shoes to them. So today, we have to find out what is the felt need of people. Not ultimately spirituality and Krishna is the actual need of everyone. But people don't feel that as a need. So we have to find out what is their felt need and present spirituality accordingly. I've spoken in IIMs in India, and there are professors who actually use Ramayana and Mahabharata as source texts for teaching management principles from Ramayana and Mahabharata. And people are open to that. Now, in those texts, when they present Ramayana and Mahabharata, they don't talk about Rama and Krishna as God. They're wise characters, which is okay. We cannot expect people to accept everything right in the beginning. At least they're accepting Ramayana as a source of wisdom, wisdom text, and gradually they'll come. So we just need intelligent understanding of where people are at, what is people's felt need, and then presenting accordingly. And it is happening at a small level, but I feel gradually it will happen more and more. So we cannot mandate it. We cannot force it. We cannot legislate it. If we try to legislate it, it will create a huge resentment. How you are imposing your religion. You are imposing, you are trying to convert or impose religion on us. People will oppose that. But you present the wisdom in a way that addresses people's felt needs, people are open. Thank you. So let's move on. Second part I was going to talk about is aspire for spiritual growth. Now spiritual growth means what? We are souls, we are parts of Krishna. And Krishna is the source of the supreme satisfaction. The more we connect with Krishna, the more we become absorbed in Krishna, the more satisfaction we get in our lives. So now, as we grow spiritually, our spiritual growth is seen in the purity of our intention. It is not necessarily seen in the perfection of our execution. What is the difference between purity of intention and perfection of execution? Perfection of execution means whatever I do it perfectly. If we consider the five Pandavas, all the Pandavas are great devotees. In fact, the Mahabhagavatam talks about how Yudhishthir Maharaj is such a great devotee. Dharmaraj. But still, when it came to archery, Yudhishthir's devotion did not translate into expertise in archery. In fact, it was not even Arjuna's devotion that translated into expertise in archery. Arjuna was a great devotee and Arjuna was a great archer. So, it's not that just because somebody is a great devotee, that doesn't mean that they have to have some special abilities. Nakula and Sahadeva, as compared to the five Pandavas, Nakula and Sahadeva, we hardly know much about them. And they are not central heroes. I gave a series of 75 talks on the Mahabharata. They are available on YouTube. So, some Mahabharata characters. So, when I spoke about Arjun, there were 20 talks I gave. Because there's so much about him told. But if you talk about Nakula and Sahadeva, just one or two classes are there because there's not so much given. But still, they are included among the five Pandavas and they are exalted devotees. So just because somebody is a devotee does not mean that they have to develop some special abilities. And just because somebody does not have a special ability does not mean that they are not special devotees. They are not devotees. Actually, every one of us, our devotion is dependent on how much we want to please Krishna. If you want to please Krishna, we will grow spiritually. When I started giving classes, my spiritual master Gurudev gave me instruction. He told me that when you are giving classes, it may well be that a person in the audience may make more spiritual advancement by hearing what you are speaking than you may make by speaking it. Why is that? Because somebody might be speaking and they may think, just see how clever I am. How I am spellbinding the audience with my class. So their focus may not be on pleasing Krishna. But somebody in the audience might come in a very faithful, devotional mood. I want to learn about Krishna. How can I become a better devotee of Krishna? And if that is the case, they will grow spiritually more. So from the external point of view, somebody is giving a class, maybe a more prominent position. They may have more ability. But the spiritual growth does not depend on material ability. So wherever we are, however we are, we can connect with Krishna. Oh God. I think you'll have to left click. So Krishna has space for everyone, even those who are not specially empowered, even the unempowered, if we could use a word like that. Krishna has space even for them. In Vrindavan, there are the gopis who are exalted devotees and there's the grass in Vrindavan. And they all are devoted to Krishna. And when Krishna puts his foot on a blade of grass, that grass is fully contented by that. That the Lord has space for everyone. There's a beautiful story in the Ramayana which illustrates that. Which is that story or incident? Can any of you guess? Even for those who are doing big things, and those who are doing small things. Yes, thank you. The squirrel and the vanaras. The vanaras were carrying huge boulders. The squirrel was carrying small particles of dust. But Lord Ram said, I am satisfied with both. Because both are serving according to their capacity. So basically, Krishna is space for everyone. In the material world, certain services will be more prominent, certain abilities will be more praised. But that doesn't matter to Krishna. So we can all move towards Krishna by with whatever abilities we may have right now. And this is an important definition of surrender. We can define surrender in different ways. Surrender means to do what we can with what we have now. To do what we can with what we have now. Sometimes we may feel, oh, if only I had more time, I could do so much more service. Yes, it is true. But whatever time we have, do that much service now. Sometimes we may feel, oh, if I had more speaking ability, if I had more money, if I had more contacts, I could do so much more service. Yes, that's true. But do what we can now. So Srila Prabhupada was like this. When he had nothing, still he was serving Krishna. I was in Vrindavan and I was talking with one of the senior Vaishnavas over there. Not a Vaishnava from our movement, but from the traditional Gaudiya Sampradaya. So he was telling that his guru told him that when Bhaktivedanta Swami, Swami Maharaj, as he, Prabhupada is known over there, when Swami Maharaj was in Vrindavan before he went to America, at that time he was so, he didn't have any money, so poor that Prabhupada would write his books, and when his refill would get exhausted, now he said Swami Maharaj would go to the shops and he would request, I am not asking for a pen. I have a pen. Can you just give me a refill? So he had this wisdom which he wanted to share with the whole world. But he didn't even have money to buy a refill at that time. He was asking for the refill. But just because he didn't have a refill, he didn't stop writing. He wrote. One of Srila Prabhupada's disciples, Hayagriva Prabhu, he was one of the early disciples. So he knew English and he knew typing. So he saw Swami was calling, whenever he had time, he would be typing. So he asked Prabhupada, can I do some typing for you? He said, yes. I typed out one page. And Swami, do you have any more typing? And then Prabhupada, yes, he says, come. Prabhupada took him to his trunk and he opened the trunk. And then there were like piles and piles and piles of paper. And it was like, say, if this were a note paper. So normally when we write, we keep some margin in the left, right, top, bottom. But Prabhupada had no money. So Prabhupada had written from the left top to the right bottom. Every single part. And then he looked at the papers. Many of the papers were actually envelopes. Prabhupada had got some letter. And Prabhupada had taken the envelope, unwound the envelope, and made that into paper. And he had written on that. So Prabhupada had no resources, but the lack of resources did not stop him from his service. So with what he had, he did what he could then. And Krishna blessed, Krishna empowered. And now millions and millions of books have been distributed all over the world. So surrender doesn't just mean, oh, I will have so much and I will give so much. No, what we have, we give it now. Even if we have limitations, Krishna is concerned not with how much we are offering, but how much of ourselves we are offering. Krishna is not so much concerned about what is the quantity that we are offering, but how much of ourselves we are offering. Ultimately, Lakshmi is Krishna's consort. She is Vishnu's consort. Krishna doesn't need Lakshmi. He is always with him. Krishna wants our heart. And the idea, the principle in giving charity is also what? Ultimately, we want to give our heart to Krishna. But our heart is caught in so many things. Our family, our professions, our this, our that. So If we can't give our heart to Krishna, then we give what is in our heart to Krishna. If we can't give our heart to Krishna, we give what is in our heart to Krishna. So wealth often has a prominent place in our heart. And so when we give some charity to Krishna, by that what happens? We give what is in our heart to Krishna, and by that we give Krishna a place in our hearts. So if we feel, oh, if I have more money, I will give more money in charity. That is good. But the important thing is, do what we can now. Because ultimately, Krishna is not concerned with how much we are giving, but how much of ourselves we are giving. That's why the spiritual growth is completely independent of material facility. Material facility, material ability. Yes, we could do more service if we have more ability, but we can make spiritual growth, we can connect with Krishna independent of how much material ability or material resources we have or we don't have. Any questions about this till now?
The balance comes in our life when we look ourselves. But what happens is that as a devotee, when we were new, that time we just looking at ourselves. But as the congregation grows and as we meet every Saturday and then over the period of time, it becomes comparison among the devotees also. Then how to make this balance actually in that situation?
Okay, yeah, good question. Actually, this answer will come in my next point. Yeah. So, this is the last one we are talking about. Last couple of points. So, when we talk about our devotion, we all want to make a contribution. The test of our devotion is not how much appreciation we get for our service. It is how much absorption we get in our service. That means, let's say if we are trying to share Krishna Bhakti with others and a lot of people come and a nice community is developed by that. Yes, then other devotees may appreciate us. Oh, you're taking care of such a good community. Not only other devotees may appreciate us, the visiting which has come. Oh, it's impressive, so many people are there. So we get some appreciation. Now this appreciation is not necessarily just pandering to our ego. That appreciation also encourages in our bhakti. We are also reciprocating with those devotees by giving them a forum where they can speak. So it could be just a human need, it could also be devotional reciprocation. But the important thing is that appreciation does not determine our devotion. The devotion is determined by how much absorption we are getting in our service. So I was at a temple in South India. It's a small temple, and there was a pujari who devoted his life to that temple when he was 9, and now he's 75. And every day for the last 66 years, he's been doing this puja. And nobody knows him. He's not a great speaker, but the fact that he has been able to continue that service day after day, month after month, year after year, you could see that he has a connection with the deities. He's absorbed in that. And that's great spiritual advancement. Somebody might be able to give very powerful classes, but while they're giving a class, they're thinking, you know, why are so few people come? Why is this person not come? Why is this person not come? Now, if it is out of concern, that is good. But it's out of insecurity. Don't people appreciate my glories? Don't they understand what good classes I give? If that is there, then their spiritual advancement may not be that much. So, we have to see that the test of our devotion is our absorption. The more we are getting absorbed in Krishna, we are growing spiritually. Now, of course, because we are a part of a movement where we want to share Krishna Bhakti with others, so we would like the results at the material level also, the external results. We want to make more and more of a contribution. But that is not the primary thing. So if the comparison intensifies our service and then that increases our absorption. That is good. But if the comparison makes us dissatisfied. So for example, if we go to some other center, some other place, and we see that there are so many devotees over there. I was just in the Middle East, and all the in the Middle East there is a lot of social restriction for religion, but there are hundreds and hundreds of devotees there. It's very inspiring to see that. Now seeing somewhere else, how many devotees are there, that may inspire us. Oh, let us also plan, let us also try to share more. And that enlivens us, that's good. But instead, if that makes us dissatisfied, even when we are doing our japa, we are thinking, oh, why so many people come over here? When we are doing our worship of the deities, we are doing our puja, you know, people don't come on, what is the use of this? Then that is becoming, like I talked earlier, cancerous. That the desire itself is not bad, it's good actually. We want more and more people to get Krishna's mercy. But that desire should not become greater than our desire to connect with Krishna. So we want, only when we are connected with Krishna can we connect others with Krishna. But if in trying to connect others with Krishna, we become disconnected from Krishna. Then it's like we go to save somebody who is drowning and then we start drowning. Then somebody else has to come and rescue us at that time. So we have to keep our priorities clear. And the most important thing is to ourselves be Krishna conscious. And if we are Krishna conscious, we can help others to become Krishna conscious. But instead of Krishna conscious, being Krishna conscious, we become number conscious. We become conscious of many other things which are related with Krishna service, but they may distract us. So then we have to refocus. Is that clear? Thank you. So, one more point? Okay. So, to conclude this, I'll quickly summarize what I spoke and then we can have a few questions. So I spoke broadly on this topic of learning to live with our limitations and within our limitations and to avoid unnecessary dissatisfaction. So I talked about how even people who are super achievers in Ivy League universities or top companies, they are also dissatisfied. And even devotee community, we might be dissatisfied because of unhealthy comparison. Because in today's world, we are so interconnected digitally that the whole world can become our comparison point. And that's why even if we are in a reasonably good situation, still we may feel dissatisfied. So we discussed the correlation between material possessions and satisfaction. If basic needs are not met, then increase in wealth leads to increase in satisfaction. Actually, it leads to decrease in distress. But beyond that, there is no correlation. It depends on the individual person's nature. It's his personality, their disposition. So making money is important, but what we are making with money is even more important. What we drive is important, but what drives us is even more important. So the values for our life, the purpose of our life, that is ultimately what will make us happy. And that we understand from our spirituality. So we are souls. Krishna is the supreme soul who is all attractive. And connecting with him in devotion is the source of the supreme satisfaction. And spiritual growth means to connect with him more and more. And for connecting with him, we don't necessarily need material abilities. So lack of material ability does not signify lack of devotion. Angad and Jambavan couldn't jump. They admitted it and they served in their own way by performing austerities for invoking good wishes on Hanuman. So they were equally devoted in their own ways. So similarly for us, if we focus on connecting with Krishna and we have a proper definition, a proper conception of what spiritual growth means. Spiritual growth doesn't necessarily mean increase in material abilities by which we can do visible services more. Even if our service is invisible, but still if we are getting absorption in Krishna through that service, we are growing spiritually. If we are seeking more and more for appreciation from others and not getting that and feeling dissatisfied, then we are missing the point of Krishna Bhakti. So we live in a society where comparison and competition are somewhat unavoidable. But comparison and competition should be functional things. They shouldn't become a part of our fundamental identity. no matter how disempowered we may be, like a tiny squirrel, still we can connect with Krishna. Krishna has space for everyone. And when we grow spiritually, if we are getting absorption in Krishna, then we will be satisfied. We will be Krishna conscious, and we will make help others also come to Krishna consciousness. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. So any questions?
Hare Krishna, it is quite enlightening in this discussion. I just want you to know that sometimes our destiny is fixed. We cannot change our destiny. Only a little bit we can change if we surrender to the Krishna. Say, even a devotee like Yudhishthira, we understand that when they were playing that pasa, that time Duryodhan told that my mama will be doing the Sukuni will do the play for him. But Yudhishthira also could have used his brain that my chachera bhai like Krishna will do the then it would have been changed. But then there would be no Kurukshetra war. So sometimes destiny we cannot change. Even Mahajan like Bhishma Pitamaha, he was in the other side. If he was not in that side, then there won't be any war. So how to,
we have
to believe on Krishna's plan rather than our plan.
Okay, yeah. Good question. Sometimes are certain things destined that they are anyway going to happen, and should we try to make our plan or should we depend on Krishna's plan? See, the two are not necessarily opposite. Even our plan can be a part of Krishna's plan. I'll explain how. With respect to destiny, it's a very revealing incident in the Mahabharata. Before the Kurukshetra war, Vyasadeva comes and meets Dhritarashtra. And Vyasadeva is also persuading Dhritarashtra to try to control Duryodhana and to avoid the war. Now, Vidura is much, much stronger, but Vyasadeva is also persuading. And at that time, Vidura and Vyasadeva, both of them say that if you don't stop Duryodhana, the war will wipe out the whole Kuru dynasty. So at that time Dhritarashtra says, if it is the will of destiny that our dynasty be destroyed, then who am I, a tiny mortal, to stop the will of almighty destiny? And that time Vidura replies, O king, it is the consequences of our actions that are determined by destiny, not our actions themselves. It's a statement worth memorizing. It is the consequences of our actions that are determined by destiny, not our actions themselves. So that means, say, if a student is preparing for an exam. Now, after doing the exam, how many marks they will get, or what is the caliber of the competition, where they will be placed in that competition, that is not in their hands. That is determined by destiny. But if before the exam itself, the student doesn't study and say, oh, my results are determined by destiny. They are not determined by destiny. Now they are being determined by your irresponsibility. About 20-25 years ago, when I started giving spiritual talks, I was given a guideline, 10 guidelines for speaking in public. And the last guideline was, depend on Krishna. But in bracket, depend on Krishna, but only after you have prepared. So if I am coming to give a class, and if I don't prepare, and I say I am dependent on Krishna, well, that is irresponsibility. So there are basically, in surrendering to Krishna's plan, there are two aspects to it. The surrender itself can be in two ways. One is dependence on Krishna and the other is diligence for Krishna. So Draupadi's surrender is by she raises her hands. I am helpless, Krishna, please you help me. Dependence on Krishna. But if we see Arjun, he hears the Bhagavad Gita, which tells Arjun, Sarvadharman Parityajya Mamekam Sharanam, surrender to me. That's 18.66. And 7 verses later, in 18.73, he says, Karishye Vachanam Tav, I'll surrender to you. But Arjun's surrender is not raising his hands. Arjun raises his bow in readiness to fight for Krishna. So that is diligence for Krishna. So that's why I said, sometimes if we are working sincerely for Krishna and we are planning our service accordingly, then our plan can also be a subset of Krishna's plan. So now, how do we know when we should surrender by dependence on Krishna and when we surrender by diligence for Krishna? So that is, let's look at the second part. Now, I said the incident. Vyasadeva comes to Dhritarashtra after the Kurukshetra war is over. And at that time, Dhritarashtra is lamenting, all my sons are dead. He's very, very morose. And then Vyasadeva tells Dhritarashtra, O king, do not lament. This war was destined. Now, was the war destined or not destined? The point is that we can't know what is destined. So, in general, the simple way to understand this is, there in life, there are some things in our control and some things that are not in our control. So, with respect to the things that are in our control, we surrender to Krishna by diligence for Krishna. And for the things which are not in our control, we surrender to Krishna by dependence on Krishna. So basically, in every situation in our life, when we have a particular responsibility, we try to do it the best that we can. And we make plans for it. So like Rath Yatra is coming. Now, many of you may be planning very carefully. Okay, how to do this, how to do that, how to do that. And that's required. But if sometimes things beyond our control go wrong, then we accept it as destiny. We accept it as Krishna's plan and move on. That's how both work together. So when we are planning and when we are striving, at that time, we should think that it is my responsibility to do my best. But after we have done our best, if things are going out of control, we don't have to obsess. Now Krishna has some other plan. Krishna will take care. I don't have to obsess about it. Okay. Thank you. Yes, Prabhupada was like that. Good example. Thank you. So, yes.
Hare Krishna, Guru. Very nice class. Thanks for explaining this. So, Arjuna himself heard Gita from Krishna himself directly. And Pandavas also were great devotees. They all followed Dharma and fought the Mahabharata. And if we see, Kaurava were against Dharma and they tried their best. And in that, they got killed and they went to Swarga. But Pandavas, even after being on the side of Dharma and Krishna was supporting them, they went to Naraka. As a devotee, how do we understand this? I mean, instead of doing all this, then if this is the outcome, how do we understand this?
Okay. So, is it that the Pandavas went to hell and Kauravas went to heaven? And how do we understand this? The Mahabharata does describe this, but we have to see the broader context. The principle there is that actions have consequences. Every single action has its consequence. So now, while being a Kshatriya, while fighting a war, the Pandavas sometimes had to do some things which were not exactly right. And at a material level, certain material consequences may come. But it is not that the Pandavas were permanently in hell, and nor that the Kauravas were permanently in heaven. See, heaven and hell are also temporary places. And the Pandavas went momentarily to hell, they saw hell, That is, the idea is that actually if something wrong is done at a material level, a certain material consequence may come of that. But that is only brief. And the Kauravas did attain Swarga, but that is also temporary. Their disposition was not heavenly. And they didn't stay there for long. The Bhagavatam gives us a broader picture. The Bhagavad Puran explains that the Pandavas were great devotees and the Pandavas ultimately attained the eternal spiritual world. So different incidents in scripture, they are meant to teach particular things. And we have to focus on the right lesson. Like say with Yudhishthira gambling. Some people may say, if Yudhishthira was Dharmaraj, if he gambled, then why can't I gamble? Now, okay, we could reason that way. But the Mahabharata's point is that Yudhishthira was Dharmaraj, and despite being Dharmaraj, when he gambled, he got into so much trouble. So if we gamble, we are not Dharmaraj, how much trouble we'll get into? So the lesson over there is radically different from what somebody might draw from it. So the point of the Mahabharata is never that by dharma you will go to hell and adharma you will go to heaven. If that were the point, then why is so many dharmic characters, in Vyasdeva has written the Mahabharata, why is he coming and trying to tell Duryodhana to stop from doing adharma? Why is the Mahabharata filled with all dharmic instructions? The point over there is that if a particular person does a particular activity, they get a result for that. So for a Kshatriya to fight in a war and not be a coward and run away from the war, that is considered heroic. Yuddhe chapya apalayanam. So Kshatriyas, if they do not run away from the war, they are fearless to fight, then that is considered heroic. That's a virtue for Kshatriyas. So because the Kauravas exhibited that Kshatriya virtue, they didn't run away from the war, they fought and they died in the war field, that's why they were elevated to heaven because of that. But that doesn't mean all their past actions didn't count. That they will get, because of that heroism in dying on the war field, they may attain heaven. But again, that is temporary. If they have an adharmic disposition, that adharmic disposition will not let them stay in heaven well. And by that adharmic mentality, they will come down and they will again degrade themselves. The Pandavas, circumstantially, if they did something wrong occasionally, they may have to temporarily get a reaction. But that is temporary. That is not permanent. That's why we have to see the broader context. Dharma will always bring good, adharma will bring bad. But the Mahabharata subtlety is that the Mahabharata does not paint characters simply as black and white. There is black and white, but in real life, it's very rarely black and white. In real life, there are lots of shades of gray in between. And the Mahabharata paints characters at various shades of gray. So Karna, for example, is very much in that shade of gray. So is Bhishma and Drona. They were great characters, but still they chose the wrong side. Even Yudhishthir is not fully white. The gambling match is very, there's something which is in the shade of gray. So the Mahabharata, in a sense, reflects the reality and complexity of the world we live in by depicting different characters. And that subtlety is also depicted in the Swargarohan Parva, where it talks about how heaven is attained by different characters. But heaven and hell are also temporary, and is an eternal destination beyond that. Does that answer your question? Thank you. Any of the Matajis have any questions? Yes, please. Sorry, come again.
Krishna is a powerful God. Why he chose Arjuna as the main leader?
Okay. So, why did Krishna choose Arjuna? There are different levels of answers. Ultimately, we'll have to say, we have to ask Krishna. Because Krishna is a person and he has his personality. Personality means he has his preferences. You can say, why does Krishna play a flute? Krishna could play some other instrument, isn't it? He's a person. As a person, he has his personality and his preferences. Having said that, we can also look at certain explanations which are indicative. We can't know Krishna's mind. But in our Shastra, certain points are made. See, when Maharaj Yudhishthir, sorry, when Pandu wants to have sons, and he comes to know that Kunti has a blessing by which she can invoke the devatas and get sons from them. So at that time, he first says, the king has to have dharma. So, he says, invoke the god of dharma and ask for a son from him. And Yudhishthira is born. And he says, actually dharma is important, but bala is also important. Without bala, just dharma alone will not work, especially for Kshatriya. So he says, bala is personified by Vayu. So ask for a son who will be very powerful from him. And then she has, who is that? Bhima. Bhima, very powerful. But then, he says that actually, the king of the heavens is not Dharma, king of the heavens is not Vayu, is actually Indra. And the Mahabharata actually has a very respectable way of depicting Indra. So he says that actually a prince should have not just Dharma and Bala, but he also needs to have Dakshata, he needs to be expert, he needs to have expertise. And all these are inadequate without Bhakti. So he says, please ask for a son who will be having expertise. And then she invokes, she asks for Indra, and Indra has, she has Arjun. So Arjun is, his desires also evolve. And he recognizes that expertise combined with devotion is what is most specially required. And then of course, after that, Matri says, you have three sons, I don't have any, please. Please let me also have a son. And then she invokes a god. She invokes. Kunti says, I will chant the mantra for you. She doesn't give the mantra. And then she, with that one mantra, she invokes two. The Ashwini Kumaras. And the Ashwini Kumaras are powerful gods, but they are not anywhere the top gods. So Nakul and Sahadeva are born from there. So our qualities, the qualities a child has, there are multiple factors that determine it. There is upbringing. There is the quality of the parents, the quality of the soul's impressions from the previous life. All those matter. So here if we consider the gods from whom they are fathered, as well as the kind of desires which invoke their birth. We see that in the case of Arjun, the desire is the deepest and the most evolved for Pandya. Along with that, also it is that this Jiva Goswami explains in his book Gopal Champu that when Krishna left Vrindavan, he was constantly remembering Vrindavan. And anything or anyone that reminded him of Vrindavan became very dear to him. So in Vrindavan, Krishna had a Gopa friend named Arjun. And among the five Pandavas, there's only one Pandava who had that name. So Krishna formed an instant bond with Arjun because Arjun reminded him of Vrindavan. And that's how their connection became the deepest. But still, he had a connection with everyone. And Nakul and Sahadev, Krishna could have empowered them. And Nakul and Sahadev also have their own valuable roles. Sahadev is the person who brings down Shakuni in the Kurukshetra war. He takes that vow and fulfills that vow. Nakul also, some prominent warrior on the opposite side, he brings them down. So they also have their significant roles. But the Mahabharata is clear in describing that each one of us can have our individuality, and our particular individuality may lead to a certain kind of limitation at a particular level, but at a material level. But that does not mean that we are limited spiritually. Everyone can be equally exalted in terms of devotion while being different materially. And Krishna's empowerment, whom he empowers, that is his swaraj, this is his independence. And we accept that one person might be empowered, one person might not be empowered, but everybody can be connected with Krishna and can be enriched by the devotion to Krishna. Okay? Yes, ma'am. We have time for questions? Okay, last question. Yes, ma'am. Does the karma of the okay, it's a good question.
Yeah, karma of the parents, does it impact on the children?
Like, what do you mean by karma exactly in this context?
Like bad karmas, like if the parents are doing something wrong, like if somebody is in the administrative position and they take the bribes and they do very bad karmas, like either parents, does it the result okay. Does it fall on the children?
Okay.
Like their fate, is it? That they stand
something wrong. So, if the parents do some bad karma, like say they are dishonest or take some bribes, does that affect the children? So, first thing to understand is karma is logical connection of cause and effect. We shouldn't think of karma to be like a mysterious contagious disease that will jump from one person to another person. It is not like that, and karma is logical, it is not diabolical. Diabolical means that it is just somehow evil influence going from here to there. So the principle underlying karma, Bhaktivinoda Thakur talks about this in Krishna Samhita, that the principle underlying karma is that we are responsible for our actions. Our actions have consequences, and therefore we should be very, very careful about our actions. That's the fundamental principle. Now, regarding the consequences, how far the consequences will go, that is gahana karmanogati. That is complicated, that is difficult to understand. In general, the more influence we have, the more responsibility we have, the more empowered we are, the more consequential our actions will become. Say, if an ordinary citizen becomes angry, they might just yell at someone or pick up some things and throw at someone. They might break some glasses, break some windows. But the president of America becomes angry, he might press a nuclear button. Thousands of people can be killed. So depending on how much position, power we have, our actions have greater consequences. Just as we see this principle at a visible level in today's world also. So we can say karma is simply an extension of the cause-effect correlation that we see in our day-to-day world. It's an extension because things which you have done in the past, even a past life, can come on to us in this life, the reactions to them. And also the reactions to our present actions may come in a future life. So in that sense, the normal cause-effect correlation is extended further by the principle of karma. So with respect to the parents' actions affecting the children, it is not that because the parents have done bad karma, that does not mean that the children will themselves be directly affected by that bad karma. Child is a soul on his own. And a child will have their own karma, and that their karma will determine their destiny. At the same time, actions have consequences. So for example, if the parents do something wrong and then they are caught for that, then that might lead to a scandal, a disgrace, and that will affect the children also. So it is not that the particular action itself will, like in a subtle contamination kind of way, affect the children. Is it that because the parents are corrupt, the children will also become corrupt? Not necessarily. If the parents are openly talking about it, and parents, that's all the impressions that the parents do, that's the kind of samskara that this is what you need to do to succeed in life, then child will also become corrupted. But if the parents are not doing that, they're just doing that because they feel this is what I need to do to live, And then that kind of mentality may not come in the child. But actions have consequences. So in that sense, the more responsible position we are in, the more cautious we need to be. But we don't have to use karma to create fear in people. Fear is required. But as I said, karma is not like a mysterious contagious disease that somehow this karma will jump from here to there. Karma is basically actions having consequences. So our actions do have consequences. In that sense, the children can be affected very much by the actions of the parents. In fact, Bhishma tells Karna that because he was conceived in sin, he was conceived by the union of Kunti and Surya before marriage. Because of that, his mentality is corrupted. And that's why he couldn't accept the good advice of Krishna. When Krishna told him, and come outside of the Pandavas, he just couldn't accept it. Now it's important to understand, what does this mean? Does that mean that Karna did not have intelligence? No, Karna was intelligent also. Karna had ability also. But at that time, without the proper union in a dharmic way, when a child was born, then at that time a soul who is not pure was attracted. And then the story is also told about in the Mahabharata that Karna was a demon in the previous life named Sahasra Kavacha. And he had taken shelter of Surya. And Surya had given him shelter because that was Kshatriya principle. But then eventually he wanted to get rid of him. So when Kunti called him, he used that as an opportunity to transfer Sahasra Kavacha onto forwards. So that means that particular action, which was done in an adharmic way, premaritally we could say, so that given opportunity for an adharmic soul to come over there. So that way we can say that actions do have consequences. So we have to be careful about our actions. Does that answer your question?
I understand that you mentioned that if your actions are caught, then the consequences in society, the children may affect it. If I'm doing something wrong, which is only that belong to me, like nobody knows about that, but I have done that mistake. Mm-hmm. So those consequences, okay. It only will be belong to me or it will fall on my children.
Okay. So if, say, if we do particular actions and the consequences are not, we're not caught for it. So then then the consequences only come to us or to others? I saw once a traffic notice, a person was speeding and a cop caught him. So the cop said, didn't you see the speed limit? He says, yes, I saw the speed limit. I just didn't see you. So sometimes we may think that action is wrong only when it is we get the consequence of the action. So if we don't get the consequence of the action, then it is not wrong. We may think like that. But the action is intrinsically, some actions are intrinsically themselves wrong. You know, consequentially that wrong result is not coming immediately. So now, who all is affected by which action? That's a complex chain of karma. So for example, if the head of state of a particular country is hot-headed and they cause a weapon of mass destruction to be shot. Now it is that person's hot-headedness is there, but the people who are victimized by that, it is also their karma at that time. It's because of their karma that they were there at that time and they were victimized by that. So like that, if say the parents are doing something wrong and if the parent is caught, then the child is also affected. If the parent is not caught, the child may not be immediately affected. But that means if the child is affected or the parent gets caught, that means we understand the child may also have had some karma because of which the child had to have, had to be in a family where there'd be scandal or bad reputation or whatever. So in general, the consequences of our actions come to us. And if others are also victimized by those consequences, that means they also had some karma. But we don't know that they had the karma. It is the important thing is for us to act responsibly. So if our consequence is not caught, that simply means not that the consequence is not going to come, but it's just that, okay, that person may not have had that karma and the action may not, result may not come. Because see, it's the action, as I said, destiny determines the consequences of our actions. That means sometimes we may do a particular action, but the result may not come immediately. Like say some people, they, nowadays everybody is very weight conscious. So some people, they just eat a little bit and maybe their health gets spoiled, their body seems to balloon out. Some people may have some genetic predisposition towards gaining weight. Some people may have some, various factors might be there. Some people, they treat their tongue like a conveyor belt. Just keep eating, but nothing happens to them. They still say thin and slim and... Now why is that? Now that means the action of eating, its consequence is determined not just by that particular action. If somebody by their past karma is meant to have a sickly body, then just a little bit food imbalance and a big problem because of that. Somebody by their past karma is meant to have a healthy body. Then even if there is some impropriety in eating, there is no immediate result of that. That's why the results that we get right now, they are a result of not just, the result not just from our present actions, but also from our past actions as our destiny plays out accordingly. So for children also, whether they get the consequence of their parents' actions or not, that depends on the children's karma also, the parents' karma also, not just present karma, also the past karma. So that's why we don't have to get too much into this hair-splitting mode of which action will have what consequence, on who all will it affect. We just have to be cautious about our actions, and sometimes small actions can have catastrophic consequences, because sometimes that combination may come up. And we are doing something, small mistake, but if the past karma is unfavorable at that time, then the small action can have a terrible consequence. I know one of my friends is in America, is a traffic cop. So he was telling that there was this boy, he got a license at the age of, first he got a license, driving license, when he became adult. And his first drive, he was driving happily, and he had got passed the exam also nicely, he was driving. But he was an avid baseball fan. And he had his phone in front of him, and he was looking at the baseball scores and driving. And something happened in that match, and he just looked at it. He looked at it, and at that point, he was driving through a school area, and a child ran across. And just knocked down the child. And a small inattention, but a terrible consequence. You know, he lost his license, he was disgraced, and the child was severely injured. He survived. So many of us, we sometimes just look at our phone and drive and do so many things. Sometimes nothing may happen, but sometimes something terrible may happen. So the present action's consequence is not just determined by the present action alone. When it's present action with our past actions, they combine together in an unpredictable way to determine the result. Okay. So thank you very much. Shri Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai Gaur Premanande. Prabhupada ki, Jai.